to get to be back in this space, which is a rather historic and unique one here in Wilmington. But the whole point of coming to talk with you today, we're going to start with this three-part series on the specific and pull our way back out to the broad. So today with the very specific, Margaretta Elizabeth Lamont DuPont and her connections to the very place you are sitting. You know, what does she have to do with this and how did it all kind of come to be? So we will start with her. This is Margaretta Elizabeth Lamont DuPont, who lived from 1807 to 1898, known within her own family as Meta or Mita, depending upon who you ask the question of within the DuPont family. So she came into the picture whenever her family moved to Wilmington in the early 19th century. She ended up becoming a contemporary of the daughters of Eleuther Irénée DuPont. So E.I. DuPont is the person who started the Black Powder Company just up the road. You may have heard of the DuPont Company, so he's the one who started all that. So she ends up becoming friends particularly with Sophie DuPont, the youngest daughter, with Eleuthera DuPont, the next youngest daughter. And so what you're seeing is one of the drawings that Eleuthera DuPont did in the early 19th century about life at the house. And what you're seeing, the red dress, this is Meta DuPont. And what it's depicting, of course you can't really read all of the stuff here because of you're so far away from it, but this is a cat who comes in a fit. And what this is saying is, oh my goodness, the cat's in a fit. Oh my, what should we do? So it's the hijinks with the cat. So this is what's going on. And of course, the cat's name is Rousseau. You know, they all love their French philosophers and thinkers. But Meta DuPont, Meta becomes a big part of this family by knowing the daughters, by being a part of everything that's happening at the Eleutherian Mills residence with all of the people who are living on the Brandywine. So they end up becoming pretty close friends. Throughout all this, she meets Alfred Victor DuPont, oldest son of E.I. and Sophie DuPont. They get married on October 28, 1824. So they end up striking up a courtship by virtue of this connection with the daughters, so with his sisters. Meta DuPont ends up becoming someone beloved in the family, and when they find out that Alfred Victor wants to marry her, everybody's just absolutely ecstatic. They think that it's fantastic because they love her so much. They think that she's a wonderful match for Alfred Victor. So much so that they even build them a house. So after their marriage in 1824, if you come to Hagley and take a tour today, this building is the Eleutherian Mills residence. So this is the DuPont family ancestral home. This is the Brandywine River. This is the original part of the DuPont powder yards that they built in 1802. So the house they built for Alfred and Meta is right here. So it's called Nemours. She loved that house, and it's still in existence to this day. That family members still own it. You can see it this time of year from Hagley. Whenever you're on our property, you can look right across and see it. The inset is a photograph of the house from the mid-19th century. So they're part of this life on the Brandywine. They are front and center in the midst of everything. After Alfred Victor becomes head of the company, she's right there with him throughout the entire operations of the company. So she ends up becoming head of the household. So she's not involved in operating with the DuPont company in any way. But she's the one who is kind of the matriarch, seen as one of the matriarchs of the DuPont family along the Brandywine River. And someone who a lot of the sisters, brothers, everybody who were around felt like, you know, kind of ruled with an iron hand. They all knew her as somebody who's kind of watching out over everybody, making sure that you read your lessons, making sure that you're doing everything that you should be doing, keeping up with all of the latest information, not giving your parents any fits. You know, everybody knew that Meta DuPont is somebody who was kind of looking over your shoulder and there to kind of keep everybody and everything in line. She gets depicted a little later. So this is a little book that Sophie DuPont did. So she did these little, and they are little, the whole thing is about this big, small books depicting life on the Brandywine. So what you're seeing here is scenes from a day in the life on the Brandywine, and the image that you see at top are of all the daughters reading. So Meta DuPont is one of the people who is depicted in this image as reading with the daughters. So they took part in musical entertainments and reading, so she helped make sure that they had good books to read, were reading the proper things to know what you need to know to be a sophisticated person in the early 19th century. So this is all going on in the 1820s, 1830s. And at bottom, they're seeing one of the neighbor's new children. So as life goes on, so too does she become an integral part of everything. Even to the point that she is painted by Rembrandt Peale. If you come and take a tour at Hagley, one of the things that we are happy to show off are the Rembrandt Peale paintings of the DuPont family. So in the 1820s, 1830s, E.I. DuPont paid for the artist Rembrandt Peale in Philadelphia to do paintings of all of his daughters, of his father, Pierre Samuel DuPont de Nemours. The only person who wasn't a blood DuPont was Margaretta Lamotte DuPont, who got painted as part of this group. So they thought so much of her that they paid to have Peale do this painting of her. And this painting, by the way, is one of the ones that we have at Hagley Museum and Library. But this just shows you how integral she is to the family life at Eleutherian Mills on the Brandywine. She has seven children, and all of these children end up becoming important in their own way. And I'll point out a couple that we'll come back into the story a little later. The oldest child is Victorine Elizabeth DuPont Kimball, top left. Second child, Emma Paulina DuPont, top right. Third is E.I. DuPont II, depicted at bottom left. So if any of you have heard of the Nemours estate, near the Alfred I. DuPont Nemours Hospital, that's Alfred I. DuPont's father, E.I. DuPont II. The next child is Lamotte DuPont, who comes into this in a big way, that a lot of his children end up becoming successive presidents of the DuPont Company, not the least of which is Pierre Samuel DuPont of Longwood. So the guy who started Longwood Gardens, that's Lamotte DuPont's son. Then Alfred Victor DuPont, who ended up going west, he's one of the few of her children who didn't stay here. He ended up in Louisville, Kentucky, where he died in 1893. Then Mary Sophie DuPont, and then Antoine Bitterman DuPont, who is the father of T. Coleman DuPont. So hold on to some of these people. A few of these are going to come back into the story as we progress. And so to give you another sense of Meta DuPont and kind of who she was, as she was kind of known by some family members as a strict authoritarian, the person who's kind of riding herd and making sure that everybody's doing everything that they need to do, she's also known as someone who's fun-loving and taking part in kind of this grander life outside of the Brandywine. The drawing that you see at top left is by a fellow named Robert Griffiths, who was a family friend. He drew a lot of pictures of things that happened on the Brandywine, but the person at the piano is Meta DuPont. She was known as someone who had musical entertainments in her house, that she loved music, she loved poetry, she loved reading. So one of the things we have in our collections is her sheet music, that she bought sheet music prolifically and absolutely loved performance. So the program that you see at the right is for a musical program they held during the American Civil War, where they performed some of the latest music of the day and made a whole kind of a program out of it for which their family, friends, anybody around can come. But they're so serious about it that they actually print a program. So it's not like they just write this down on the back of an envelope. They print programs and hand them out to everybody who comes along. So this is something that they're pretty involved in, feel strongly about. Now, Alfred Victor DuPont died in October 4th, 1857. Wasn't an old fellow whenever he died. This is a bit of a turning point for Meta DuPont, because not only is her husband gone, but that kind of shifts her role within the family. So she is not just Alfred Victor's wife now. Now she's one of the elder statespeople of the family, along with Victorine DuPont, the oldest daughter of E.I. and Sophie DuPont. So after Victorine DuPont's death in 1861, Meta DuPont becomes this kind of headed person, the head woman of the DuPont family. They all look to her for advice. They all look to her for help with anything they need help with. They also look to her for all the gossip of the day. So she's one of the people who keeps up with all the news of the family. She lived in the Nemours house, which was depicted earlier, until 1869 when she moved to Goodstay. So if any of you are familiar with the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute, just back up Route 52 here, that's the house she lived in. That her family bought it. She bought it in 1868, moved there in 1869, and lived there until her death. So that's a little bit about her. Now let's get back into the connection with why we're all here, this church itself. This is Daniel Lamott, Meta's father, that he moved to Wilmington from Baltimore in 1855. He became a member of the Swedenborgian Church in Baltimore, and so whenever moved here was the nucleus of a group of people who formed a new society in July of 1857 that he, all of his children, some other community members, with Daniel Lamott in the lead, they officially get together, make themselves an organization in July of 1857, he being elected as first president. He's also the head of what would be the building committee to decide where they're going to put together a building and what it's going to look like. They came up with a pretty strict set of regulations of what they wanted. They wanted it to be a Gothic church. They even stipulated what they wanted the arches to look like on the windows. I mean, it's all written out, you know, pretty explicitly exactly what they wanted with their layout for the church. So they move ahead, they buy a piece of property, get everything rolling. So they lay the cornerstone for this church, not right here, but its original location, a little further down into Wilmington on August 6, 1857. And so the society became officially incorporated in the state of Delaware on February 10, 1858. And then the building itself is completed and the sanctuary dedicated on April 29, 1858. And where it originally stood was at a intersection of 11th Street, Delaware Avenue, and Washington Street. And so that's about a mile in that direction down toward the center of Wilmington. Of course, nowhere close to where it is right now. It's also interesting to point out that a lot of how people identified where the church was that it was right behind the Garfield Monument. So Garfield being a former president of the United States, James Garfield. So that's where a lot of people knew how to figure out where this church was. Now, Meta DuPont was one of the people front and center in organizing this church. But notice that, let me back up a slide, that the cornerstone's laid. It becomes a thing in 1857. The church is done in 1858. That's a year after her husband's death. Alfred Victor DuPont was somebody who was pretty adamantly not atheist, but not religious. That he wanted absolutely nothing to do with much of the organized religion on the Brandywine. And that was just a lot of his personal belief, that he had no objection to other people being involved, but he himself didn't want to be involved. And so with his wife and her being involved with a society here in Wilmington, it's something that didn't bother him again, but he didn't want to have any part of it. He also didn't want to have any part of anyone trying to organize churches on the DuPont Company property. That one of the family reminisces is that he pretty famously said that anybody with a collar on who came to his property, that he would throw them into the Brandywine. And unfortunately, he didn't actually do that. But a lot of her involvement with getting this church organized and started and being one of the leading members happens after his death. And so I don't think that it's because he had any kind of restrictions on or told her not to. I think it's more that after he's gone, she gets herself involved to help move herself forward, to not think about the death of her husband, to just move on to a different chapter in her life. And so there's a precedent for that with her sister-in-law, Victorine DuPont, who after her marriage to a fellow that only lasted a month before he ended up dying of pneumonia, E.I. DuPont set her up as head of the Brandywine Manufacturer's Sunday School as a way to kind of shift her attention, help her come back in to the world as he saw it, instead of sitting around and being, you know, just so down in the dumps that her husband died. And that's something that she took up and became superintendent of that school and stayed head of it until her death in 1861. So she's a pretty important person to getting all of this started, to making sure that the building gets built, that the church gets established, that everything is moving forward. So upon her death in 1898, this is this thing is not all that big, it's only about this big, a small painting of her from close to her death. When she died in 1898, she left a $15,000 trust to her sister, Mary Hounsfield. And so the idea with this money is that her sister Mary would live off the interest, and all this money was invested in stocks, bonds, other things having to do with the DuPont Company. But that she would be able to hold on to that money, live off the interest until her death. So upon Mary Hounsfield's death in 1905, according to Meta DuPont's will, the money was to come to the New Jerusalem Church of Wilmington. So think about that. $15,000 is a lot of money in 1905. That was the church was absolutely blown away to get it. So the person who negotiated this, made sure that everything happened as it should, was Pierre DuPont. Think about Pierre DuPont of Longwood Gardens. So he was the head of the DuPont Company, kind of the head of the family in a lot of ways during that era. So he wanted to make sure that his grandmother's will was carried out and her wishes were carried out. So he had communication with the then society to make sure that they got the money the way they wanted it. He even asked them, do you want the money outright or would you rather have the investments? You know, that's completely up to you. So there's a lot of correspondence with Pierre DuPont where they're trying to figure out exactly what they want to do with the money to make sure that they get it and can use it to the benefit of the church itself. So that sets up the church in a big way after Meta DuPont's death to have this chunk of change to be able to do maintenance on the building, to be able to keep the congregation going. Now the family comes back in to the story in a big way in 1917 with the widening of Delaware Avenue. So many of you have probably heard of Pierre DuPont and the widening of Pennsylvania Avenue, Kennett Pike, all the way out to Longwood Gardens. Also T. Coleman DuPont and DuPont Highway downstate in Delaware. One of the things that these two fellows took up in a big way was roads, that they wanted to improve the infrastructure in Delaware and especially in downtown Wilmington. So before Kennett Pike got widened, Pierre DuPont got involved with the widening of Delaware Avenue, in part to help traffic flow down around the DuPont building to get everybody more into the downtown area. So in widening Delaware Avenue, keeping in mind that this church was on the corner of Delaware Avenue, that they needed the space, they needed the property. So Pierre DuPont, through his lawyers, he himself, and through T. Coleman DuPont, approached the church about, what are we going to do? We need to move this thing. So how are we going to negotiate this? And in the end, what got negotiated was that Pierre DuPont paid $112,800 for the church and the property. And this was in 1917. That the church would be responsible for relocating the building. But in reality, Pierre DuPont helped out with that quite a bit because he ended up hiring someone who was able to take this place apart stone by stone and move it. He also used T. Coleman and his own lawyers to help figure out what's a new piece of property that the church could buy. Where are we going to put them? So we need to make sure that wherever this church is built, that's going to be far enough away that if a road gets widened, we're not going to have to tear it down. So Delaware Avenue is out of the question. Let's move up Pennsylvania Avenue. So Pierre DuPont even paid $300 on top of all this to fill in the hole that the church left whenever it was taken apart and moved, and for the site of the sanctuary and the parsonage. So it was a pretty big deal that they were willing to put that much money over into the property, into the church itself, to make sure that they could move, relocate, and wouldn't be out of pocket for anything. Don't forget, Meta DuPont was these two guys' grandmother. You know, that they felt pretty strongly about her and her belief and how closely tied she was to this church. So they wanted to make sure that her wishes were carried out, but also that the congregation could carry on. Neither of them being particularly religious people in their own right, but they just wanted to make sure again that because it was meant so much to her, that it could continue on, that they wanted her memory to be a part of the bigger picture of how things would roll with the church. So things are fine, well, and good until 1927, whenever the program starts to widen Pennsylvania Avenue. So whenever the church established itself at this spot, T. Coleman DuPont rightly realized that at some point they were probably going to want to widen Pennsylvania Avenue. So he and Pierre DuPont had a bit of an argument among themselves about how closely the church should be to the road. So T. Coleman DuPont invested some of his own money in buying property that the church could expand into. Again, realizing that if the Pennsylvania Avenue gets expanded in any way, then you're going to have to think about what's going to happen. Are they going to have to tear down the church? Are they going to have to move rights away? How is this all going to work? So with the new location, what you're seeing is the map that shows where the church is currently located, where they wanted the street line to be, where the street line was. So there was, fortunately for the church itself, once Pennsylvania Avenue got widened, because T. Coleman DuPont argued the point that it should be moved back a little bit instead of placed where the church originally wanted it, now we don't have to tear the church down. You know, so this is a little bit of forward thinking on their part to make sure that the church is going to stay in place, that they wouldn't have to go through another program to move it again. It's also well to point out that whenever the church got moved, yes, they moved it brick by brick, stone by stone, piece by piece, but they didn't set it back up exactly as it was put up in 1858. That in the negotiation with the congregation, they did change a few things, like that whole end of the structure, to make sure that it could be set up so that it could be a lot more usable, that the community hall would be a little bit bigger, that the entrance, the exits, that everything were going to be set up the way everyone wanted it. So it's about 80% the way that it was in 1858, and moving it here in 1917. You know, but that's a pretty interesting thing, too, because, you know, for the most part, it's all the way it was. You know, so they kept the spirit, if not the letter of the law, so to speak, in moving everything and getting it set up here. But that's something that T. Coleman and Pierre DuPont are involved with in a big way, and helping make sure that everything is just so, and it's the way that the congregation wants it. Again, looking back to their grandmother's involvement with this church, wanting to make sure that her memory lives on, and that her what she wanted for this church was going to end up being what was. So that's what leads us all to where you are all at today. You know, so think about that while you're here. I mean, I do a lot of digging into DuPont family, DuPont company materials. That's part of my job at Hagley, is I spend a lot of time digging through these materials, looking for local history things, looking for family history things, DuPont company things. One of the things I tell people about is that whenever I moved to Delaware in 2006, one of the first things everyone said to me was, "Welcome to the state of DuPont." To which I kind of chuckled and thought, "Ha ha, you're right." And they're like, "No, really, welcome to the state of DuPont." And it was meant, you know, not as a negative thing, you know, but more just to kind of clue me in, because I worked at Hagley, to how deep the connections were between the DuPont family, DuPont company, and everything really that happens in Delaware. That the more I dug into local history, the more I see how the family, the company, has a lot to do with how not only the local churches look, but how Wilmington itself looks, how the state of Delaware looks. And good, bad, or indifferent, that's the history of where we are. You know, that these people are so heavily involved with all of this stuff. And where I've been pretty fascinated as an outsider coming to this is that it's an interesting history to see these people that get portrayed a lot of different ways, but at the heart of it all, they really love their community, you know, that they love where they are. And I'm, again, not saying this because I work for Hagley. I mean, this comes out in the records in a big way, that they truly love this community and didn't want to see anything bad happen to it. So put a lot of money into things like making sure that churches were whole, not just this church, but other churches that were in the route of Pennsylvania Avenue or Delaware Avenue. Pierre DuPont loved trees. He didn't want to see any of the trees that were along the route get destroyed. So he put a lot of effort, time into making sure that trees got transplanted, that all of the landscaping was done properly, that any property holders along the way were made whole for their losses for having to expand these roads. But, you know, even with the company itself, this is something that comes out, that a lot of the engineering work that went into moving this church to widening these roads came out of DuPont Company Engineering. So they had a tremendous engineering arm by 1905. You know, it had turned into the 20th century, they could pull off projects like this because they were one of the largest builders in the state of Delaware. So if you wanted to expand a road, who else would you go to but the DuPont Company? They knew what to do. You know, and that's part of why they were pulled into all this, not just because of the DuPont family and their connection with the DuPont Company, but the DuPont Company had the wherewithal to be able to take on something like this. Because moving a church is not an easy thing, especially if you're moving it stone by stone. I mean, you can't just get anybody off the street to do that. You have to know what you're doing. And making sure that it gets from point A to point B and incorporating the alterations that the congregation wants. You know, so that adds another level of difficulty to this. So that's where I want to drop you off with all this, is to think about that, you know, whenever you're in this space. You know, that it's, of course, not just the DuPont family that's involved with this, but they are one of the major players in getting this church established here in Wilmington, making sure that this building is set up the way it is, and in all of the construction projects in the city to make sure that it lands here and doesn't get moved or disturbed in any way. So with that, we'll open it up for questions, comments.